that were extended to several contractors to do roads. Now, Madam Speaker, it is, or let's say the Tenders Board Act was constructed in such a way that it is expected that any contract over a particular amount of monies, I think the limit is 20,000, should go to public tender. It is well understood that sometimes due to the urgency that you have to negotiate on a bilateral basis and sometimes go to selective tendering. But Madam Speaker, with all the claims of transparency coming from members on the other side, they have not been going to public tendering. They have been given contracts for millions upon millions of dollars to individuals and private entities to do different things, including construction of roads, without going to public tender. So whereas you may have individuals out there who are better equipped to perform these services, Madam Speaker, they are excluded. And that's what happened in the case of the appointment of David Shaw. And I want to say here, Madam Speaker, when you look at the fact that Ambassador David Shaw does not and still do not have the competence, the training, or the qualifications to preside over such a project, to play such a role as a coordinator for the single largest project, capital project ever in the history of this country, I want to say today that Ambassador David Shaw was an oblong peg in a square hole. Not a round peg in a round hole, an oblong peg in a square hole. And Madam Speaker, we are seeing this type of situation in which they are undermining the tenders process. For instance, I have here a schedule of a number of contracts that were extended and which I'll share with the Honorable House. I see here Antigua Concrete Services, and that is Thomas Charles, Senator Charles. I have no personal issue with him, but the reality is, Madam Speaker, this man is a senator of the UPP government, and he has been given millions of dollars in contracts, Madam Speaker, to build roads. Not only to supply concrete, you know, to build roads. And,
did he build roads at the stadium, you mean?
I don't know where it could be. But, Madam Speaker, oh yes, this particular one here leads to the stadium, so maybe he did part of it. The Pickett's Main Road going to the stadium, I have it here, Madam Speaker. It says here that he was paid, or he was given a contract of $4 million to do Pickett's Main Road. And at the time when this particular report was done, $580,000 was actually paid. Madam Speaker, this is the type of weakness within the governance framework that we continue to speak about. And by the way, you know, there are many others there. I just don't want to go down that road so that you derail my debate. But, Madam Speaker, the reality is government contracting in this country has some fundamental weaknesses. And I hope that the members on the other side, I know that the member for St. Philip South, when he speaks, he's probably going to turn this thing into a comedy and get personal and so on. But he has to understand that we have to have systems in place to guard against the abuse of public resources. Because we're a small country, we have very limited resources, and the people of this country elected the UPP government to get good value for money. Now, obviously, if they can't get good value for money, then they have no other alternative but to get rid of them, so that they should not see this form of criticism as being personal. It is about ensuring that there is balance within the system. And, Madam Speaker, I take my role as a member of the opposition very seriously. I am being paid to play this part. I am a fundamental part of the governance of the country, and my role is to examine issues like these and to give my opinion without fear or favor. And again, as I said, I'm not here to bash anyone. It's just a matter of using a few names to elucidate certain points. So that at the end of the day, we have to make sure that we strengthen the governance framework in this country to provide better value for the people of this country. And Madam Speaker, just imagine what would have happened if the UPP government had a stronger governance framework in place. The member for Rural East was successful in raising taxes. In fact, revenue levels have been the best ever in the history of this country. But what is happening? You have a leakage within the system, Madam Speaker. So that the members on the other side, they need to understand that by spending the monies appropriately and making sure that there's good value for money, that they're also helping the fiscal position of the country. It means, therefore, that the deficits that the present government is chalking up will be less. It means, therefore, that more monies will be available to subsidize certain things. I mean, perhaps, you know, the member says that they've been subsidizing petrol, Madam Speaker. Perhaps if the UPP government was not such a wasteful government, they would have had more monies available to do more social programs, to provide more subsidies, perhaps to even widen the list of exempt goods and zero-rated goods so as to bring relief to the people of this country. So that I want the members on the other side to understand the nexus, Madam Speaker, between good governance and government contracting, to understand that they are integrated, that by virtue of getting better value for money, you're able to better provide for the people of this country, especially the poor and the vulnerable. And again, Madam Speaker, speaking generically about the issue of corruption, it is well known that corruption impacts negatively on the standard of living of the people. So that is why we have to make sure that there are systems in place. And I'm going to belabor this point so that the members will ensure that proper systems are put in place to curb against these excesses, Madam Speaker. And I don't want to go on and on. In fact, I know my other colleagues would like to contribute to this bill, but I just want to sum up here, Madam Speaker, by stating that we expect this particular issue to be addressed in a serious way. We do not believe that the call for an inquiry is an unreasonable one. We believe, Madam Speaker, that it is a just cause, and we believe that it is in the interest of the UPP government to take us seriously, not to try and wish this issue away, not to trivialize it, not to come with their form of government rhetoric. Because at the end of the day, Madam Speaker, it is the UPP that is in government today. It is their stewardship that is being examined by this resolution. And I know many of them, when they speak, they're going to come with their former government rhetoric. But perhaps, Madam Speaker, if they were a more effective opposition, if indeed some of the things that they claim to have happened, which I have no evidence that they did, then perhaps they would not have happened. But I want to say here, Madam Speaker, the little time that we have in opposition, because we will not be in opposition for much longer, we will ensure that we hold the UPP government accountable. And I don't think that it is in the interest of good governance for them to become defensive and then to attack members on this side. Because I know, for instance, Madam Speaker, having listened to the member for Rural West and the Honorable Attorney General, I heard him threatening one of my members over here, trying to intimidate him. In other words, Madam Speaker, they're trying to say, look, you should not speak. No, Madam Speaker, we have a role to play in the governance of this country, a fundamental role. And it doesn't matter what may have happened before at this point. At this given point, we are examining a particular issue. The spending at the Cricket World Cup, we have demonstrated, Madam Speaker, that we have not gotten good value for money, and that based on what has transpired there, there is a need for an independent inquiry for this issue. Now, what else, Madam Speaker, do we have to do to get the ears of the member for St. John's Rural West, the Honourable Prime Minister? Are we going to have a public demonstration and put tens of thousands of people on the road to get his ear, Madam Speaker? And Madam Speaker, when you look at the precedent that was set by the Antigua Labour Party, in some instances, just based on a mere allegation, has held inquiries on various issues. Some of them were just pure political rhetoric. Here is a situation in which we have presented the nation, this Honourable House today, with tangible evidence confirming that there are some fundamental issues, issues of corruption, issues of extortion of state resources, issues of bad governance, and yet still, the members on the other side will not heed our call. Madam Speaker, I want to say here that that if this matter